Talk, what?
Yeah, I was Mr. Hollywood, yeah. I was Mr. Hollywood of Riot Entertainment. And my job was to bring Hollywood on the phones of Nokia. Didn't really work out. I mean, I would think twice being that kind of a building and putting something in this guy. Or not to mention the five other ones. Look at me. Can you see me representing Hollywood now for these guys? They must have really been on something, you know. I'm Max Hacklex. My job was to bring Hollywood on the phones of Nokia. I gave it a try. I really did. But we fucked it up.
Six young men from Finland are about to get $20 million to start a revolution. A revolution in mobile entertainment. Nokia, SoftBank UK and Rupert Murdoch trust them. For the moment, they are the leading players in the world of mobile entertainment. 666 working days later, it was all gone. What the fuck happened? Where the fuck did all that money go? Helsinki. Year 2000. Besides its wonderful nature, enchanting people and fascinating culture, Helsinki is also the mobile capital of the world. 80% of households have mobile phones, while the worldwide average is 8.1%. No wonder that it is here where the idea was born to start the mobile revolution. With SMS games. I beg your pardon?
I mean, what a stupid idea. That really is like the basic idea of whole Riot first 2 years. It's so ludicrous.
I guess the idea came from the fact that investors were looking for exactly this kind of a plan.
The figures that were talked about and discussed about the size of the wireless entertainment market back then were in billions, you know. If you could grab 20% of the market now, which was tiny, and create that perception that you were going to be a real player in this industry going forward, then you were going to be a multi-billion dollar business in 4 or 5 years' time.
So the founders all get together, have a great idea. They don't put any money into it, not even credit card-based money at that time. They go out and were able to put together a business plan, pitch it to someone as large as Nokia Ventures, and to have it be funded.
In a way, you could say we created this team to commit a crime.
They all had kind of different roles.
It was supposed to be roles, but I guess it was more for image.
As when you rob a bank, you need one guy who can start the talking.
One guy who could pitch things.
Excited and talking about the game.
Third guy who will handle the guns.
One guy was handling technology.
And you need a fifth guy who can do the driving away.
Someone else was a bit more about the business. And
one guy was the lawyer.
Every person in the gang had its own role to get the goddamn fucking money.
All of them, including myself, were absolute nobodies. They had nice CVs, but anyone can have a nice CV.
If you look at the team, Jan was the ultimate leader. He had collected us.
He's charismatic.
He's a no-sex person. I mean, he's not a man, he's not a woman, he's
crazy, a bit.
he can immediately break the ice with some phony joke.
Well, actually, we're just joking in the back room that we'll probably get 3G online when I am engaged in intergalactic travel.
Every time he was presenting something, he took this flatboard, and then he was drawing different size of sausages.
Basically, I think he's a great people raiser.
He was keeping us five other guys as dolls.
He's right there with Adolf Hitler and the guys.
Well, John was like Mr. Hollywood of Riot.
John was, I would say, a super manic, depressive guy. You saw less of the depression, more of the manic side of him.
Just running around the world, and when he was in place in Riot, the office.
He was excellent in creating ideas.
He was just going mental around the house.
His main strength is in destructive behavior.
I remember one case when they'd been to see some Hollywood studio moguls. So the thing that he came up with, he took his glass of red wine and threw it on one of the film moguls just to kind of differ from the crowd.
Posse was a very, very smart kid.
He looked so young, fast speaking, joking, ordering drinks.
But very aggressive.
Posse was the politician.
He actually believed in what he was trying to do. And that kind of energy that came out of him was unique.
Jani Halme, he was Mr. Mobile.
Extremely creative guy, but I never understood a word of what he said to me.
He was the only guy of us six who was completely passionate with the idea of creating mobile games. But in every other sense, he was so full of shit.
Mulla on menossa 52. Matkapuhelin tässä 11 vuoden aikana.
Extreme liar. Extreme bluffer.
Meidän korteilla, meidän rahoilla ei ole Helsingin julkiskenessä ketään juotettu.
Something holy almost about that. Henry was
very creative in writing legal contracts.
He wasn't a dry lawyer. He was more of that. He was more of a player.
And because the rest of the guys were not interested in the finances, and Henry's a lawyer, close enough.
Kare was like the music industry guy, and he had this connections to bands in Finland and some international connections as well.
He was in a fairly stressful mood, however. He was spending a lot of energy with his previous company. It became obvious very quickly that the additional energy that he was supposed to use with the new company was going to be overwhelming.
One down.
Fight.
Selling a business plan is always a process. And we were selling a business plan that had nothing to do with technology. And no one was doing that at the time. We were the first guys who came there and said, fuck it, we don't know anything about technology. What we want to do is bring the missing link into this equation, which is content. I think I went to over 40 meetings. I was pitching in maybe a dozen conferences where you would have 50 or 100 investors. I got a cold shoulder from everyone.
I heard about Riot because they were doing a lot of noise. I couldn't say, you know, immediately what, you know, attracted me about Riot. What I can say is that I've been attracted by Jan Wellman.
We were meeting so many investors, and I was pushing this idea that I think I was building a sort of a snowball factor where one guy was calling the other guy who had already heard the idea.
And then we stayed on the phone, you know, probably 3-4 hours together, and then I, you know, my desire started to, you know, to grow.
And at that stage, you know, you can guide the investors, not because they are greedy, but because they have an ego.
But you know that the entertainment industry is sexual. I think that Jan was representing also this, you know, this strong desire. It's driven by some pulsion and some sexual pulsion, completely sexual.
Anybody can get cash from investors, even in bad times, if he has enough intelligence to hold two balls in the air at the same time. If you can say that I have
confirmed interest. I have someone who wants to invest on this side.
He started to say, when he went to one guy, he presented it first, went to the second guy, he always said that guy wants it.
To the other guy. And he will say, okay, under these circumstances, we will invest. And then you can go to the third guy, the third ball, and say, I already have two.
He just was spinning the word that everybody wants us, but nobody wanted us. He just said so.
It's not a matter of lying. It's a matter of building an image for your investment.
One night, Jan wanted to go out for a beer and share his discussions with the financiers. John, he put his hand over my shoulders like, John, today I've been talking to the finance. Today I've been talking to all these finance. I talked to six guys.
John Major was part of the decision process.
I was lying to the left, lying to the right.
James Baker was part of this.
And at the same time, I was making sandwiches. And you know what, John? I have come to the conclusion that a lie is not a lie, actually, until it's revealed to be a lie.
Traditionally, you would say, this is a lie, because I'm not telling the truth.
When you start the lie, and until it's revealed in between, it's true.
In fact, exposed, you're not lying, because you're making it real.
This was fascinating to listen. In a way, I was, of course, envious that he can make sandwiches and just keep lying on the phone and get the biggest salary. But what the fuck, man? Who wouldn't like to do that?
That management of ego was a brilliant job, because at the end of the day, I had one Finnish investor who said, I can put $10 million into a bank account tomorrow in cash. Just sign with us. And I would say, I have to think about it.
Buying cash,
building,
liar,
we were
sexy, energetic,
pitching,
same business model,
exciting,
and frustrated, buying cash.
Every second
line, I have Marlon Brando.
Flying cash,
building,
riot,
lie.
De facto truth.
So I was very satisfied.
It's not
to lie your way through,
no.
Lie becomes true.
Young man, we want you.
We were six founders in the beginning, and we had claimed to the finance we had 15 people hired. We didn't have anybody hired.
And then when we got the money, we realized, oh. Damn, now we actually have to do all the things we promised.
We were in a pretty nice jam.
We had promised we have services.
We had no technology.
We had promised we had brands.
And we had no applications.
We had nothing.
So, I mean, challenges were plentiful.
We know who you are, and above all, we know what you can do.
We needed people, and of course we needed professionals.
The investors had the idea. They drew me a curve and said, look, the value of your company is dependent on the number of people you have hired.
You gotta have 100. 100 is what you need.
I said, you mean I burn more money and the company is more valuable? I said, exactly. And it looks like this.
You have to join us.
In order to get the type of personnel we needed, we had to really pull some personal strings.
Mormonien palkkaaminen oli fantastinen idea. Terve suomalainen firma toimii niin, että sinne palkataan ainoastaan kolmea uskontokuntaa. Mormonit tekemään työt, protestantit johtamaan töitä, juutalaiset myymään.
We had Nokia and we had News Corporation who owns Fox Studios. So in a way we should have got the best people in every way. But for some reason, we got like relatives, yes.
We had couples, several couples.
We got alcoholics, nymphomaniacs.
Siblings.
Desperate, self-supporting mothers.
Childhood friends.
I think some guys were actually taken for the bus stop.
Se ei täysin pidä paikkaansa. Me palkattiin meidän tuttava ystävä piiristä. Missään tapauksessa se, että hei, saat mun serkku tuu meille töihin, niin semmoista ainakaan mun tapauksessa ei käynyt.
Getting that many people on board so quickly is a tough task.
You know, there weren't positions that were going to be filled, but they actually got in the 40, 50 people, and then they started looking like, what could this person do and what could that person do?
If they wanted to be a brand manager and that made them happy, I mean, yeah, right.
do that, be a brand manager type of thing. We didn't, of course, have any brands at that time.
And some girls were needed for just sexual habit or whatever. It's just like, so we have the number filled, like the quota, 100.
Mä pidän meidän rekrytointipolitiikkaa niin kaiken kaikkiaan erittäin onnistunut.
The employees of Riot also included a Russian senior high school student, a former television announcer, a Mormon priest, a former porn star, and a punter from the dating service. That's how we recruited in Riot. More after this break. The Riot's portfolio of products included a wireless party, a service that started the new era of modern democracy. Now the citizens had a straight channel to expose their views to the members of parliament by using SMS voting. A launch with the leading tabloid magazine of Finland, the Wireless Party Engine, asked citizens important questions like should smoking be forbidden in public places, if porn should be banned on television, and acceptance of the common law marriage of the President of Finland. The answers were no, no, and yes, but the President of Finland got married anyway. Riot Date was the first mobile dating service in the world. The engine searched suitable partners for the users and enabled anonymous chatting using SMS messages.
They chat and they chat and they chat and they chat.
Okay, I think I get the point.
Until finally they...
die.
Oh, they meet each other for real.
Oh.
Riot Date was one of those products, besides Wireless Party, that these three guys, Pasi, Jani and Henry, were supposed to have delivered already by the launch of the company. But ironically enough, it didn't even exist. But they had the idea.
If there was someone else within the vicinity of, I think it was 100 meters or 50 meters, then I would get a text message saying, oh, my perfect match is 100 meters away from me and things like that.
And so we started to develop it. At some point it was done.
I guess in Finland that game, I don't know if it would have been able to sell because of the privacy issues. In Finland you can easily go in a place where there's only one person in addition to yourself within 100 meters.
So the only ones using it was our own employees.
And the main product was MoBuddy, an epochal wireless version of Tamagotchi that was forecast to be the most significant success story ever in wireless entertainment.
Essentially, MoBuddy was a application that would work like a synthetic personality over your mobile phone. Nokia's analysts took a look at the application and made an estimate, a financial estimate, if this works, how much could it be valued at? And based on this huge, huge Excel analysis, the valuation of that concept, one concept alone, was I think over $2.5 billion.
As the main designer of MoBuddy, a sound student from a Finnish film school was hired. What the hell? He's in the entertainment business. That's close enough.
Back then it sounded like an okay idea, until I saw the documents of MoBuddy. These people who had created this document, they were totally out of their mind. They had...
Mä todennäköisesti luotiin, jossakin vaiheessa luotiin ihminen. Virtuaali-ihminen, mutta ikävä kyllä semmoista ei ole saatu aikaiseksi edes MIT:ssä.
I understood it would take several hundred man years to make this MoBuddy to work.
Musta oli fantastinen idea ja on vieläkin, joskin se jäi idea-asteelle.
But the first major launch of Riot was Titan AE in Hong Kong.
The game is based on the new animation feature film by 20th Century Fox.
Which is not that hard to guess, since they have the same name, both of them. Anyway.
We had to create a little bit of noise around the fact that you could actually do something on your mobile phone except talk shit.
The first Hollywood brand we got was Titan AE. It was like animation, science fiction, film. Since we had an organization and we needed to get some game developers, and those guys were like 3-4 Mormons, they presented the game to the management of the company. And nobody understood the rules.
Titan, A, demo, take 5. Sound, camera, and action.
I have humans, the motherfuckers. Okay, you first.
We're pitching this to the telecom company, and we had all these funky demos of how it goes, and
functional demo, as we call it,
which was absolutely insane.
嗱呢度咧就话嗰个兜巴星人喺今次嘅袭击行动，我用咗3种武器，而呢句咧就系漏打嘅信息嚟嘅。佢就话埋单啦你，你个老母屎啊嘛。
And they really kind of couldn't grasp the logic of the game.
What is this?
Fantastic! You just play with yourself from now on, you mother.
Okay, I will. I like playing with myself. I can play with myself all day long.
Totally misoriented humor.
So we simplified it. Well, it wasn't actually simplified, and it was basically true that it's actually the
rock, scissors, and so on.
Paper, scissors, and rock.
The rock, paper, and scissors game.
Like, what?
Mm-hmm. We explain again, and then just weird thing happened. They, oh, yeah, the poo, and
this is like in my childhood
with the whiteboard and playing as it's like, oh, excellent.
With John, we were just like sitting there. What the hell just happened? I mean, rock, paper, scissors. But it was a big launch there.
Yeah, they arranged this show where I had no idea. I just walked into Jackie Chan's nightclub, and they had 100 chairs. And I asked, who are these people sitting there? And they said, well, they're journalists, reporters. And then they gave me this plastic gun that was shooting laser beams. And I said, okay, what am I supposed to do with this? Well, as soon as the light hits the floor, you're supposed to shoot with the laser gun all over the place. And you can shoot, for example, the head of 20th Century Fox, and then you can shoot the telecom operator. And I said, well, it sounds like a great idea. Of course, what happened is that, I guess it was a little bit too soon, that the challenge of playing a game against a server with SMS just wasn't there yet. So the usage was very low. And we learned a lot about how to do this business.
How to do this business.
The marketing that Riot was doing, even that early stage, was some of the best I've seen in the world.
There was this investor who was going around marketing department and were showing stuff, and he said, well, I've seen this. This is the reason I'm here.
Riot Entertainment takes you on a journey to the darker side of the Marvel Universe. Meets the judge, the jury, the executioner, the Punisher, the mobile game.
Flash demos we were able to put together, the one-sheeters, the graphics that were coming out, the PowerPoint presentations.
Otherwise, you're just another gaming company, but your marketing and your image is way out there.
I didn't see the like of it before, and I haven't seen the like of it after.
As the most remarkable mobile entertainment company in the world, Riot managed to purchase exclusive mobile rights, among others, to the Bridget Jones Diaries, the Guinness Book of World Records, and to all Marvel comic characters, including the X-Men movies. Join the Generation M now.
The thing that really did it for me and my boss, you know, we were sitting in this small little conference room talking to Alan. I was going through his whole spiel of what they could do for us. What really did it for us was he brought out the brochure that listed all the movie properties that they had lined up.
It wasn't a very good idea to make such slick and very good and convincing marketing material that we had.
My boss and I huddled after that, and he said, you know, whatever we do, you gotta bring these guys in and make sure we close the deal with these guys before they go talk to anybody else.
Okay, the pitches went great, we got deals, but in the end user would get disappointed when, you know, the hype was so great.
There's really nothing to this game, you know, it's rock, paper, scissors.
And what you get is a text message.
But because it's X-Men, rock, paper, scissors, it's the best thing in the world. And that's exactly what it was.
And the most enthusiastic player of X-Men, the mobile game, was Mr. Stone from the Philippines.
I'm Mr. Stone, I'm gonna kick your butt.
Asia was the main area where these kind of services were being picked up by users. It wasn't happening Definitely not in US. A little bit in Europe, but Asia was getting crazy.
My classmates, I think like about 2 of 5 tried the games, the right e-games, but they didn't get far. I can't remember how many I used to send a day, but at the end of the competition, over 9,000 messages.
People that didn't have money to buy food were spending money on SMS. So it was an obvious choice to get traction.
I couldn't afford to pay for the game myself, so my dad had to pay for it.
Father was a bit pissed off because the bill was huge. But anyway, Stone got his PlayStation.
I want a PS2, a cell phone, and a TV. It's all because of Riot. Thanks to Riot, I have my PS2. I never knew that me playing a game would make me a legend.
Are you mad enough to be a mutant?
Within a year, Riot Entertainment has offices in Helsinki, London, Paris, Berlin, Rome, Los Angeles, Singapore, and Manila.
In the beginning, we were like a family.
The sky was the limit. There was nothing but upside in the industry.
We agreed to meet 5 in the morning.
And we don't leave before 10 p.m.
One of his favorite phrases was, there is normal speed, there is light speed, and then there is riot speed. And that was exactly the, you know, the feeling.
I was dating a girl with whom I was only for 2 weeks, and she was staying at my place. And I saw her only between 2 a.m. and 4:30 a.m. And every day I was, you know, in this pressure, and every day I was so hectic that I would come back and I was pumped up with so much energy that my eyes would be gleaming with this kind of crazy, crazy energy. And she would say, listen, I can't date drug addicts. And I would say, what the fuck are you talking about? I'm not using any drugs. I'm just working hard. I have to keep my job. I have to keep this company going. And she would say, listen, I had a boyfriend and she took methane. He took methane. And I know the same eyes, you have the same manic eyes, and I can't handle it. And she walked out. She left me.
In Riot, there was a discussion, how can we get the best brains? And we came to the conclusion that we really need to have a
free trip to Mars.
Entertainment facilities.
I actually believe that you can hire a space rocket
for the people that we would hire
and shoot them into Mars. They like the idea.
Lavish office in downtown Helsinki.
Yeah, the building in itself.
It's close to Hollywood style.
Everything was taken like from the latest interior design magazine. It looked really
pompous.
It was like gliding around in a palace.
And we have breakfast every morning.
They bought so much free food to the company, they had to throw a huge amount of it away.
We had an iguana. I don't know really why we had it.
The possibilities for sports.
In some articles, they wrote that there was a huge swimming pool.
Lots of game machines.
Billiard table.
Well, it was fun to read, but I never saw the pool.
A cinema in the basement, right, with sauna complex and all the rest of it. Was that really necessary?
We were kind of forced to make it that way.
One meeting with one of the investors, and he was saying, you know, office is important, so why don't you build a fountain or something into the lobby?
We had to make it look big to make it
big. Get cool, get funky. You're an entertainment
company. Coming out of, I would say, you know, I wanted to say nowhere. I was talking about
the sauna.
About Helsinki.
It was used, I think, every day.
It's not so easy to enjoy your life in Helsinki.
When you think about it, for instance, the coders.
Most coders had access to
the sauna.
They lived in the building.
You know, I wouldn't blame them for facilities.
I wouldn't be surprised if some of them have never had any other apartments.
I came to work and I see this bunch of coders walking around in their bathrobes. Drunk.
There was Well, what a boozing also.
Every company has their parties. Of course, when you have a lot of money, you have better parties.
It's sort of like when you work hard, you play hard.
Koko kaupunki puhuu kuitenkin teidän bileistänne. Ne olivat tämän megalomaaniset.
Yeah, for some reason the parties we had at Riot are very famous around the town.
Sinä et siis myönnä mitään, että olisi ollut mitään suurellista, grandioosia elämäntyyliä.
Kyllä, tästä bileistä haluan sen verran, elikkä ne oli hyviä bileet. Fantastisia bileet.
It was not only decadent fucking parties and drug parties, they were also like children parties.
Ja kyllä siellä mun käsittääkseni on paljon myös elosteltu.
There were affairs, of course, like in any normal company.
The floor guard, who actually came in and found people in the most unbelievable positions in one of the beds or one of the other beds on the floors, whomever. I mean, they probably all used that same bed.
And the most notorious expressions of the riotous sexuality in the company were the group sex sessions in the sauna, organized by the coders of Riot.
Sex session? With whom?
The one with your five.
Oh my god. Hei, otteksi suihin vai kumpaan? Vedetkö kakkosen? Rokko!
As proof of the group sex sessions in the sauna, a group of Riot employees filmed an erotic dogma movie, Portimot, that was later reviewed by the leading lifestyle magazine of Finland. It was also a great success at its premiere in the first annual Forest Film Festival, and bootleg copies are still spreading all over the country.
I was given an order in the beginning that I should create the company should have an image of Riot.
I said, what we need here is Hannibal Lecter as a 5-year-old child on acid.
We don't make games, we create riots. That was the strap line.
We're the craziest. You know, sort of like no limits. Of course, that was the reality too.
Like the name Riot Entertainment, I just thought it was a riot all the time because it was just that people came and went as they pleased.
I guess we almost overstepped the boundaries of allowing a very, very creative atmosphere.
The spirit in the company was fantastic, and it was like working with friends.
We lost contact with most of our friends outside Riot.
What comes to work moral, people worked, but it was sometimes hard to know when they worked, or where they worked, or if they worked.
I took a 2-hour nap every day under my desk after lunch, and if I felt social, I'd go and sleep underneath someone else's desk.
And one image which describes this climate quite well is when I had arranged the guy in charge of the new media business for Coke, and we show him around the office, and starting from the reception, going up, you know, every floor, third, fourth, fifth, and people. And this guy is like, dude, where are all the people? It's like, well, new media, different hours. And this was 2:00 Tuesday.
At Riot Entertainment, instead of working, most of the people in my floor, what they were doing, they were chatting in the net using IRC, playing games.
But that was obviously in the name of educating yourself professionally.
Finns by nature are not a shy group of people. They're quite happy to tell you what they think. You know, you'd get an answer like, well, hey, we need this kind of thing to be done and it needs to be done by this time. And you'd look at a guy and a guy would look at you and say, no. And you'd say, well, okay.
There were good people in the company, but I think that then some of the things basically that they were trying to do at the moment were just a bit too ambitious.
Nobody could never practically answer any of the questions, even simple questions like, what is the character set used in SMS messages? Nobody knows.
Well, talking about mistakes, 9 months after we started building the network, we found out that the basic platform on which we were building the products had a
fundamental design error, and we had to start from scratch. How much it actually cost us is I don't want to think about.
How can there be in company with almost 100 workers, with lots of programmers, people building these networks, all these fancy things, nobody knows about the technology? I don't know what they were smoking most of the time.
Actually, it wasn't lack of budgeting. There just wasn't budgeting at all.
I would say we probably had the most accurate, most specific, and most detailed budgets ever created on this planet. The problem was enforcing them.
No one was giving any limitations. Basically, I think no one could really tell how much money was spent or even how much money did we get in.
Definitely, the budgets were there. But if the reality is changing every second, what do you compare the budgets to?
The management didn't have clear vision what we're gonna do. The strategy was changing maybe every 3 months.
Well, the model of organization, the organizational structure, I think that was done, a new one was done by the HR every second week.
If you hire people that fast, you're bound to have wrong people in the company.
This doesn't work. We just put that there, and then we put that there.
And you're bound to be changing positions, swapping positions.
Mun oma suosikkini organisaatiokaavio, mikä ei mahtunut kahdelle A3:lle, se oli enemmän laatikoita kuin firmassa työntekijöitä.
Maybe it's stressful, but I always said, you know, if you don't want to be part of it, you can always join an insurance agency. Which is very stable, very safe, and very not fun.
We had a lot of failing launches, especially in Finland. But it was one of these typical failing launches in Helsinki. And this was a major important launch this time. Nobody used the services. Nobody had heard about the services. And people were looking at each other. Whose fault is it? Whose fault is it? That's what you do at corporate companies. Blame, 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 blame. And the founders take, the guy says, let's go to the bar, takes the whole company, all the people that there are at that moment, some 30 guys, to a restaurant close to Riot office, and buys drinks. They drink. At some point, they pull their pants down.
Ei, sehän ei mitenkään ole erikoinen suomalainen ilmiö. Elikkä mä oon ollut viimeksi 2 viikkoa sitten samanlaisessa tilanteessa.
Pull the pants down and sit there with their completely nude.
Jossain vaiheessa iltaa terve suomalainen mies ottaa kaikki vaatteet pois. Ja näin tapahtui myös kappelissa, joka sattuu olemaan tosi Helsingin hienoimpia ravintoloita.
And then the owner of the bar reacts on it and says, hey, you can't do this.
Te ette saa olla täällä, jos te ette tarjoa kaikille, ketä täällä on.
And then we're talking like almost 100 people in that bar. He goes up and buys with the credit card, and we get permission to be there. And then these two guys, they just decided that let's oil each other.
Tähän kuuluu siis tähän niin kuin alasti olemiseen. Joinen riottien spartalainen paini.
And started wrestling. And there was a hell of a lot of wrestling there.
Se lähtö tuli siellä sen takia, että olisi saanut istua pöydässä alasti, mutta tämmöinen niin kuin miehinen paini alasti, niin se ilmeisesti ei enää käynyt tälle ravintolalle.
Nudity was very allowed in the company. I even witnessed, or I was opening the door one night. We had a party of some sort, and the guys of the company decided that they're gonna do this naked run. And I was the one who opened the door for the guys, and there was like 30 naked men running past me, including the CEO.
When you have that kind of energy, when you have that kind of pressure, you have to release it from somewhere. And of course, we didn't have any time to do any extracurricular activities, so it came out in weird fashions. People went to sleep in the garden outside the office. People didn't go back home. They would try to use the energy by partying a little bit too much. I think all of that was up to a point. It was constructive. But soon as the things got worse, it was
towards the end of 2001, we were starting to get a bit insulated from what was going on necessarily in Helsinki. Part of that was because the news wasn't all that good and people don't like to share bad news.
It was starting to become clear that many of the projections that we had made were off base. Certainly the amount of traffic that we had forecasted, a lot of it didn't come to fruition.
I would say we must have been talking about tens of millions of messages a day that would have been needed to make it real business.
The business model of Riot was that we basically explained to the financiers that based on the usage of services, we'll make the money back. But very soon, when we looked at our launches, for example, Hong Kong, there was no users. It was like 200 people using it in a week. And it was a bit tough to tell this figure to some of the Hollywood brand owners.
There was this one classic example that, oh, we just have to talk about mobile entertainment as it will be happening in 5 years' time. So just send out the figures that we think that will be there in 5 years' time. So that will be the truth for today.
We were fingering around and playing around with the Excel sheets, and thanks to the Excel sheet operation, he could make it look like they're still making money even though nobody's using the service.
They just thought maybe that we would grow like this. And it just didn't happen. I think the expectations time to time were very unrealistic.
Creating a vision and creating a plan requires certain talents. Executing on that plan requires different strengths. There was a growing belief within the organization that delivery on that plan was becoming increasingly difficult, or was going to be difficult, if not impossible, with certain founders still in management positions.
We had to do a lot of traveling, and once I remember I tried to combine my honeymoon with a business trip, and my wife had done some nice shopping with new Riot resources as we had in the family, and thought she went out shopping spree and was happy. And I went to sleep in the hotel, and I said, I have to go on, with Pasi. We need to talk about strategy. That's what I thought, because he is the vice president. He told me, John, join me. We need to discuss business. And he got a phone call during that night from Helsinki, and he came back to me and said, John, they've just hired my wife. And I said, come. And then we jumped into a cab. I thought, what's coming now? It's like, and he takes me to a more shady area of Hong Kong, and there it's a half-dead bordello, and I mean reading about shady places, seen movies about shady places, but this time I saw a shady place. We were passing rats in an alley before we came to this place, and we walk inside, Pasi leading like flamboyant globetrotter. And I was like feeling like a school kid together with a rock star, like, wow, wow. In a way, it's like that. And we come in, and that place had basically like the AIDS ribbon as tapestry all over. This is like, it was a heroin addicted horse, like dancing, like it couldn't move. It's like all over, just like legs and anything. I was like, what am I doing? It's my honeymoon. Pasi was having his good time, a cart flying around again. I buy it for everybody. Okay, a drink for everybody. I was like, hey, we're in a graveyard, Pasi. And I would say that was perhaps a little bit of a misuse of Riot cash.
I mean, Riot was well-funded. It had plenty of money to go out and do what it was planning to do. However, money was wasted. Significant amounts of money was wasted.
Riotilla tuhlailtiin rahaa. Ihan siis
nyt jälkikäteen miettyen täysin järjettömiin asioihin ja ihan liian surutta.
There were 25 corporate credit cards. And the culture was that if you spent money...
The investors are screaming, spend, spend, spend.
Spend, spend, spend.
And as long as you had a receipt for it, the company would reimburse.
Yeah, people bought all kind of stuff.
Flying off on Concorde.
Pasi buying his suit. And by the way, this watch, I bought it with the Riot credit card.
it's on the investors' money.
And we had all the latest equipment. It was very easy to ask.
I was the producer, so I was given the Palm and the WAP phone. I said, I can't use these. I don't know what to do with these. But yeah, but you need them.
The expenses.
And so I was, you know, playing with my Palm, not knowing what I was doing.
Personal expenses.
Yeah, she's really pro.
The entertainment budget, you know, frankly, outrageous.
One of the best examples was, and the company choke, that Pasi, he had his table and it was full of receipts.
If somebody would ask me, you know, where did you spend all the money?
Like this, they were just all over.
I couldn't give exact answer.
Because he was too lazy to make an expense report.
I don't know where all the money went. I know that probably...
They were also kind of included expenses like about strippers. Somewhere in Italy.
It was one of the parties, and there was a stripper.
Poland, Helsinki.
This wasn't any of Pasi's private things. This was actually...
It was for the personnel.
But why do I have this feeling it was a male stripper?
He was not ashamed in front of the partners for all these bordello receipts and stripper receipts. Not in any way. He actually even showed me, look.
Of course it was passed. There was nobody to sign for them.
Best mate who's passing the bills, so...
Pasi had discussion with Henry about it, and Henry was really, really concerned because he was the financial controller, and he was really embarrassed about the fact that the vice president building this kind of a mountain of stripper receipts, you know? And he actually started to put Pasi against the wall that you gotta pay for this, we're gonna deduct this from your salary. He knows that Henry has a fucking boring life, and he arranges a trip to Spain for Henry, and when they come back, Pasi proudly tells me, comes up, John, no problem with the pile of receipts anymore. No problem. You know, we were banging four hookers together with Henry. He shuts up now. It's all fine.
The main idea of the game is to attack the other players and make them cry.
You didn't comment to that?
Let's cut it here. You're not serious when you ask those things.
Do you want to cut? You should just deny it if it's not true. Just say it's not true.
The greatest thing that a founder can do is know when to let go. Riot as an organization had conflicts of interest. So when you're talking to somebody and getting somebody to do a job, yet they're your boss at the same time, it becomes difficult, especially when that person in their day job is not performing in their day job. You want to fire them. When that person is a founder and is a board member, you can't do that.
I remember walking in Copenhagen after some meeting, and chairman of the board, one of our dear investors, called me and says, you know, it's looking pretty good now. I think we can commit to the next round of investment. But can you do me one favor and ask all the founders to resign by tomorrow?
There was a comment made by one of the founders that said, I'll rather take this business down than leave it. They would have taken the company and the people down rather than, you know, gracefully step to one side.
That was kind of a tough position to be in because at least two or three of us had to definitely go in order for the investment to happen. However, those two or three were also friends. And those two or three were also the people who I set up the company with. When you relate that to those partners, that kind of makes them a little bit stressed out. And it would be a miracle if the trust between us wouldn't have eroded at that stage.
Heidän kannaltaan niin Riotti olisi voinut menestyä, jos founderi...
It's a horrible discussion to have, in a way. But you have to have it for the sake of business.
A big mistake to get rid of the original.
Suomessa meillä oli
feeling that certain people were protected.
Täällä mobiilitulevaisuus kadulla.
Would have liked to have been more ruthless.
Operatiivisen päätöksen
drivers of the inspiration. The founders.
How can you fire your wife? How can you sack your wife?
I think we would be in business today if we had limited our burn rate earlier, because we were simply burning too hard after 1 year.
Well, wasn't that boring and depressing? Now it's the year 2001. Finland has lost its position as the country of highest mobile penetration to Iceland. In Riot, the business is going poorly, the money's running out, the founders are about to get sacked, and the third round of investment is in danger. But there's still one thing that could save the company. Lord of the Rings.
One of the things that completely surprised the industry all over the place, everywhere where we went, is how did we lock into these properties? How did we get, you know, X-Men? And the real answer was psychology. It's got nothing to do with how great we were or how great the company was. But the main reason why we locked those properties was that we were entertaining guys. And John was one of the, in terms of the Hollywood mentality, he was a fucking lunatic.
This New Line deal, it was a very long process. Jan had gone down to LA, negotiated with New Line. I went down there and negotiated with them. Brad Marks, our US director, continued the discussion. And then after a while, Brad Marks arranged so that Gordon came to Finland. I was really concerned about giving Gordon Patterson a great presentation. So we went through all the people who were supposed to show whatever in the company. 3-4 tech people were prepared to demonstrate on computers services that didn't really function, but just to make it look good. It was a big show. But this guy came one day earlier than I knew he would. And he calls me, and I recognized his mobile number. And it's like, he's calling me. He wants to talk to me in private. And if we meet in private, I'm gonna give away something. I'm gonna give away the services don't function, or something else which is crucial. Can't meet this guy. So I pick up the phone, yes? And he's like,
hi, John, I'm in town.
Oh, great, yeah. But the program is tomorrow, and you know, if we have everything set for, it's gonna be great.
Oh, really? I'm in town now.
Yeah, but we'll meet tomorrow, and we're gonna be good.
Okay, I guess I take myself alone out for dinner then.
And I was like,
yes, I guess you do.
And the next day, when I walked into the meeting room, I was with purpose late. Everybody else was like, "Is John gonna come? He's gonna come." And he was like a puppy there, like running up to me. And I was like, "Okay, sit down." And then I let the guys run with the spiel. One important thing is here: I have never read Lord of the Rings, none of the books. I don't like this kind of shit. I don't like this kind of fairy tale bullshit with this kind of magical tales. But I'd read the synopsis, the backside of the books. So no, actually no really of these characters. I can't name one character without making a mistake. So I just like, I was trying to do what Jan sometimes do. I was just like, talk, your turn. And everybody had their own tasks. And it went on like that. And in the evening was time for the big dinner. But before the dinner, we had the sauna event. We're taken to the sauna. We have these skulls that I bought from an artist friend, these glass skulls. And I tried to serve him some beer from the skull. I just wanted to be like gothic and like Lord of the Rings and fairy tale shit. He's like,
I don't like drinking. I drink only soda.
And I was like, you just came off a fucking rehab or something. And everybody goes, shut up, fucking kicking my, you know, leg. And I said, shut up, John. And I was like, God, take it easy. And he was laughing, but they were worried. The guys, my partners, were like, fuck, John is fucking this up again. He's fucking this up again. And I said, okay, but you don't drink, but do you want to go to the sauna? We're going to go to the sauna. I was like,
no, you don't mind if I don't go to the sauna.
I was like, no, I guess I don't mind. But later on when we had dinner, I was like, why don't you go to the sauna? It's because you don't have a penis or something, Gordon? And he was just laughing. Everybody at the table was freezing. He was like, Joan, you cracked a bad joke. And later on, we had discussion about films. Like, we had to bring up a theme, because he was a, you know, when there's a guy who is that boring, he doesn't bring up themes for the evening. So I was like, okay, what's your favorite movies? And everybody was, you know, mentioned their favorite movie, you know. And I said Clockwork Orange, and somebody else said something else, and the third, everybody mentioned classic movies. When his turn came, this Gordon said some
Spanish weird movie he'd seen in a film festival in 1974.
And I was like, what kind of fucking ambitious bullshit is that? Can't you mention a film that we all know? And it went on like that. And we also got into matters about Japanese, and I talk very badly about Japanese and Japanese women, what you can do to them. And at some point, we find out, or he says,
I have a Japanese wife.
He was insulting head of New Line Marketing about him having a Japanese wife.
And I said, ah, fuck it, anybody can get a Japanese wife with an American passport. That's nothing.
He threatened him that he would create a mobile application that would essentially kill his wife. And he did this for several hours with this guy during a time when we were trying to close a deal with this guy.
At some point, Brad Marks went around the whole building and said, John blew the deal. John blew the deal. He humiliated Gordon Patterson. He blew the deal.
I was absolutely sure that John was basically responsible for destroying the company. But as it happens, next morning, the same guy turns up and I ask him, you know, you want to go back to US? And basically, I'm fine with anything you want to say. I'm sorry for last night. He says,
No. I loved it. I love everything about you guys.
He actually didn't want to leave Helsinki almost. He was just like,
John, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And I was like, Jesus Christ, go home. But what happens that very soon this Gordon Patterson tells everybody,
we're going to make a deal. We have a deal. John, we have a deal.
Brad comes to me and hugs me. John, we have a deal. I was like, here you go. I was like, you can humiliate them. It might function. Sometimes it's good to spank the people in power.
And that's how Riot fucked Hollywood. More after this disturbing story.
The finances came to the conclusion at some point that we needed better sales director, a better business developer than the people that we had. And they gave some advices that you should go to the major headhunter companies that exist. And Caliber One of the major ones in Europe, suggested a person called Daryl Purviance.
Daryl was our sales director. He turned the revenue model of the business around completely. What he decided to do was, we will sell Lord of the Rings exclusively to an operator within a country. It was great. All of a sudden, he de-risked the revenue model. He was very, very good in front of other people. Fantastic.
I was really impressed by the way he talked during business meetings. Keep a certain tempo and feeling, really, really make them feel good about themselves.
The first thing I remember he mentioned that we somehow had lost the deal on The Simpsons. And the first thing he said that he's going to get it back.
His role was growing. He fired people, a lot of people. He explained how the company would be structured with his friends. He got a girlfriend in the company. It was a PR girl, and she was on the list of those people who should have been fired. But he very soon discovered some special talents and qualities in her, and she got a promotion.
He was quite an interesting person to work with, because he never answered his mails. I've never received any. At the time, obviously, most of the people were communicating through email.
This Caliber One recommended, and Nokia and the Carlyle Group and News Corporation, whatever the fuck they were called, approved business genius Daryl Purviance. He had a surprise in his back pocket for us all. There was a mail that came to the highest management, and it came from an anonymous source, and it explained very clearly that Daryl Purviance was an international crook
that actually FBI had listed.
We talked to him about it, and we couldn't really get a satisfactory answer.
He was actually forced to reply to this mail. And he wrote a long, long explanation of, but the way he was writing, he was like a six-year-old, you know, untalented six-year-old.
So we had to tell the board about this. And the board went bananas.
He stole by using others' credit cards, using the company credit cards to a higher extent than anybody in Riot ever could dream of. He also had lied about all of his CVs ever. His background was not anywhere related to university studies. He had basically been working in a computer store somewhere in US in a very small town.
They were infuriated. They couldn't believe it. And actually, I think what made their reaction worse was the fact that they really liked him. And they thought this guy was saving the company.
He made the biggest deal for Riot. Lord of the Rings, this guy managed to cash out for Riot almost $3 million. And I have to say, I think we should have hired bigger, better, stronger criminals, and we would have made it.
I would say June, July, we actually had a situation where we could say that the network was up and running, that we had 158 million people connected to that network. And if you count backwards, it's only 15 months from the beginning of the company. It's not a bad situation. I think we were getting there, but we were getting there too slowly.
My job was actually to acquire content, to get brands from Hollywood. They said, it's too late for that, John. That's not what we need anymore. We need money. We don't need that anymore. We're tired of listening to you. I mean, you're talking about getting Playboy. You're talking about getting this Simpson. You're talking about that brand and that brand. You're talking about TV formats. But where's the money, John? Where's the money? Show me the money. So there I was on the bottom of our organization, and I was feeling really, really hurt about the fact that I'm not allowed to try to do what I thought I was good at.
About 3 months after our first round, the market had already crashed. Now the market was still going down, down, down. If the market would have continued the same way, then I think the mistakes we did in building the network and applications and others wouldn't have become an issue, but they became an issue at that time.
I was getting into the role of a suicidal Finn, you know, the sad Ugrian guy. Finns are known for suicide, so I knew I might pull this off. So we had a company doctor, and the funny thing is, this guy, this doctor, he looked really sad. He had like rings, dark rings like this, and he looked suicidal. If somebody was suicidal, he looked so fucking pathetically depressed. And he was fat, and I sat there and thought, Jesus, I hadn't slept that night so well with purpose, and so I was like, I never can beat that shit.
The first candidate was actually a large media company in Germany, and the largest media company in US. They wanted to invest jointly in Riot. And they sent six lawyers out of London to spend 2 weeks with us to go through every detail.
Bunnell used to do these things where he came to work dressed as a woman with high heels and a wig, just because he felt like it. And everybody thought that was okay. We used to love him for that. And one time he did that, not knowing that the investors were in the house.
So that looked pretty good, and we signed a paper. But after the Christmas, they pulled out. Nobody knows why.
The investors are walking along the corridor, and I think, I don't remember if it was Jan or who it was, just shouted. He saw Pano in the end of the corridor walking with his high heels and his short skirt. And He was kind of just showing, like, can you get out of our face that we have some investors here? And Pan is running there with his high heels, trying to get away. Yeah.
Asking me questions and why, and I said, you know, I should have worked with something more creative. I've been working with the wrong thing, you know, for 2 years, and I don't, you know, I was like, I'm a bit burnt out. And this guy, after a while, do you have suicidal, this self-destructive feelings? Yes, I do.
Atmosphere was very negative. People were not motivated. They were definitely feeling, they were smelling disaster all over the place.
That was kind of a hard times for all of us. We had our Monday meetings where we all came down to the one, to the movie hall, and you sat there and see that Monday by Monday, people being more depressed, more tired.
Well, the toughest thing you can ever do is fire people, and especially in Finland, where the atmosphere is that you get a job and it's a job security, and you have social security and you have whatever security.
So at the same time, the top management of those days had to, you know, keep themselves motivated towards the funders. Try to motivate the people inside to do their daily task, even though it was quite, nobody knew what was going to happen.
He ordinated to me sipper milk, and I said, this is something, especially with this your self-destructive feeling, it's good to take sipper milk. And I explained to my wife what I've done. She was checking those pills, and I said, they have a side effect. Ejaculation is not possible. And we were trying to get kids at that time, so it was not a very good idea. So I didn't eat any of those pills.
At the same time, we were basically chewing the last bits of optimism of our investors. And in the final day, everybody just thought it's easier to say no than just continue trying. And I think that was a Tuesday morning, a Monday morning in February. And I was expecting a green light for a third round. But during the phone conversation, all of these board members said no, 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 no. So I said, fine, I had to go downstairs and tell everybody we're going to shut down.
I was somehow liking it. I was somehow like, okay, this fucking thing, if those cocksuckers, if these corporate cocksuckers that go down to the means of trying to destroy me, then why the fuck wouldn't everything get destroyed? It's like, in a way, I was enjoying it. Like, if they wanted me out, if they thought I wasn't good for it, then nobody's gonna have anything. Nothing. And you only will have this kind of shit.
After I went downstairs and told everybody this is the end, I think I went back home and slept for a day. I really didn't feel anything. It was 2 years of super hectic time. And I thought I deserve a day of sleep.
You have a truly mad, distorted baby that you feel is rejecting you. Then you have the power still, you think, kill it. I couldn't, but in a way, I felt I had killed it. I had fucking killed that baby. I'd killed the riot baby. Killed it, man. I didn't kill myself. I killed the fucking riot baby.
Finally, in March 2002, Riot Entertainment went into bankruptcy. It had managed finally to build a network working in over 30 countries, and its latest products based on the Lord of the Rings and Marvel characters were starting to be profitable. But that wasn't enough. The investment world didn't trust the company. They didn't trust the people. And they didn't trust mobile entertainment anymore.
Did you have some real questions also?
I thought you would ask me, would I do it again?
Any experience like that is always super good experience.
It's a fantasy of how work should be. It should be that easy. It should be that motivating. It should be that liberal.
Youth for me, boring. The beginning of Riot, fucking fun.
Yes, generations will change and they will do the same silly things again. Including all the side effects surrounding Riot, either use of narcotics and well, paid women and everything.
They wanted to combine everything in the same inspiration.
They just wanted too much, too fast.
It was a tremendous experience, a ton of energy, some great people, a lot of learning, you know, and it was a fascinating time, really.
Okay, 2 years of my life was well spent on that short period in Helsinki, trying to learn something that was a visionary, but actually the visionary is now truth.
What was happening during that era, that pioneering craziness thing, it's gone, and I miss it.
For those people that really did a good job, I think it was mostly emotional investment. They put their life into Riot, and that was the good thing about it. And that made it fun. That what made it different. It didn't feel like working. It felt like living.
You don't need a freaking Christmas tree, thick and as gooey with squirrels be. You don't need the yearly holiday fine. There's no need for shopping like a fool, a Christmas dress that's so uncool. To survive, you need just attitude, right? Let the kids do the baking, set about the fruitcake, and fool around where the greener is fast. Forget all your troubles, use your butt to blow bubbles. It's time to kick some serious ass. Come on, baby, join the Christmas riot tonight. Come on, baby, it's a Christmas riot, all right. Come on, baby, join the Christmas riot tonight. Come on, baby, it's a Christmas riot, all right. Come on, baby, join the Christmas riot tonight. Come on, baby, it's a Christmas riot, all right.
Is he snoring?